Colliery managers, esteemed guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and thank you for the opportunity to address you today. I must begin by apologising for my inability to present to you in person, but I have had a whirlwind few months and despite best efforts, I was unable to physically be present. But please be assured, I am with you in spirit and sentiment on this important occasion and hope to see many of you at the Mining Indaba in May. I've been asked to speak about the future of coal and our influence on that future, which I wholly believe is timely, given the current state of world affairs and the confluence of energy issues, and in particular, energy security and energy affordability. And when it comes to the future of coal, I've always believed the plural destinies will be determined by the facts coupled with the will and mindset of the global coal value chain. And I say plural deliberately, of course, because the world has already found itself at energy crossroads, with several very clear pathways sitting in front of it. One road is overwhelmingly renewable, and it has a giant support base, believing that solar and wind power can fully replace all forms of fossil fuels and do so almost immediately. But there is a second road, quite remarkably, remains less travelled. This is a road whose street sign should read Paris. Those travelling on this road believe that, consistent with the Paris Climate Change Agreement, every fuel and every technology must be included in reaching a net zero emissions future. In 1987, I was introduced to Robert Frost in my English literature class. His famous poem, The Road Not Taken, was to this day one of my favourite poems and philosophies. It is the poem I recite from memory, and perhaps not surprisingly, it is the poem that I believe describes our current conundrum. Frost describes our journey contemplation, our choice. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both. And be one traveller, long I stood, and looked down one as far as I could, to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear, though as for that, the passing there had warned them really about the same. The past few months have highlighted how complex and interconnected our global energy system is, and particularly how complicated any journey to net zero is going to be. The so-called COP to end coal delivered a reality check for coal's energy transition, underscoring the need to move away from prescribed pathways and the importance in respecting sovereign choices and timeframes. This pathway should not be the road less travelled. From all our learnings in history, sovereignty and realism are key to sustainable outcomes. The Glasgow Climate Summit's agreement to phase down coal instead of phasing it out sent a clear message that developing economies need abated coal to keep developing, and developed countries of the West cannot be seen as prescribing what those abated technologies should look like. It also raised crucial questions about who pays and by when. Then the power crunch in Europe and China kicked in, highlighting the fragility of the world's energy system, forcing some of the assumptions around fossil fuels to be rapidly rethought. We saw nations here ensuring that both supply security and energy affordability were prioritised. It particularly underscored the interconnectedness of commodity markets. The impact of decarbonisation is being felt well beyond the natural resources industry, and we are watching the shaping of political and economic agendas in a heightened awareness of achieving energy security through diverse and affordable supply. During October last year, we watched as Europe experienced shortages of baseload power, coal and LNG, and underperforming wind power. In the UK, coal fire was restarted to meet the shortfall of wind, which makes up about 24% of its capacity. These issues, coupled with the reopening of the post-COVID economies, created supply chain disruptions and a stall or slowdown in several key industrial sectors, such as fertilisers, automotive manufacture, and digital production. Demand for consumer goods led to rising inflation, 7 to 10 points higher than pre-pandemic levels. In Asia, stronger economic growth led to greater energy demand, particularly in China, where stockpiles ran low and a ban on Australian coal reduced imports. Similarly, stockpiles dipped in India and Indonesia, causing price spikes and forced power cuts. In China, new suppliers of coal were sourced to replace Australian supply, mainly from Russia and Indonesia, and the price on thermal coal was capped to try and cool the market. Last month, President Xi reiterated the importance of coal at a National People's Congress delegation, stating that China is rich in coal, poor in oil, and short of gas, and could not part from reality. He said the green transition was a process and China could not simply slam the brakes on coal. And that, I believe, is reality talking. Delegates from across China called for more investment in clean coal technologies and new policies to shore up coal enterprises. In Australia, despite the China coal ban, new markets were found in India, Japan, South Korea, and Taiwan. Newcastle coal prices soared by 250%, close to the record high of 2008. Here in South Africa, under the umbrella of the Just Energy Transition Partnership signed with the UK and the US, officials confirmed that the $8.5 billion earmarked for the scheme needed to be directed towards closing coal plants rather than developing complementary near-zero carbon industries such as electric vehicles or the hydrogen economy, as originally intended. There is so much wrong when we don't make the distinction between abated and unabated coal. The need for a just energy abated coal transition is there to safeguard people, the workers, families and communities. Now with the Russia-Ukraine crisis further impacting global energy relationships, prices and flows, we are acutely aware of energy vulnerabilities. More than ever, we need to take a balanced, realistic and integrated approach to our energy future, an approach which recognises the energy trilemma, the principles of affordability, sustainability, particularly, and the need for energy security. An approach which recognises we have interconnected pathways, so we should not be surprised that the German economy minister and Green Party member now says the security of supplies must be safeguarded, and that now extending coal lifespan is an option. Short term it may be, he says, that as a precaution and in order to be prepared for the worst, we have to keep coal-powered plants on standby and maybe even let them operate. The latest Annual Energy Outlook 2022, released by the US Energy Information Administration, indicates a continued reliance on fossil fuels and no change in CO2 emissions by 2050. Back to the third verse of Frost's poem. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. So what does this all mean for coal? As someone who spends their life speaking to governments, investors, climate scientists, media commentators, and other global stakeholders, it means that coal is still relevant. But it cannot sustain itself by simply being there or being the same. Coal must demonstrate its true worth by speaking up on its own behalf, in its own defence, and by creating a better awareness and understanding about its widespread attributes. But moreover, it must demonstrate its commitment to the journey to transform sustainably through technology. And so, as the World Coal Association and you as members of the global coal value chain, we must unite for this opportunity. Our five-year evolving coal strategy is premised on building the coal IQ and providing a platform for our members who are demonstrating that they are responsible, insightful practitioners who see a future for coal. And we are communicating through advocacy and insight the incontrovertible coal facts, which prove that coal is needed and not in decline, but that it must move with the times. The simple fact remains, coal is the world's largest single source of electricity and will still be the biggest contributor in the fuel mix pie at 22% in 2040. It remains critical to the production of 90% of the world's cement, 70% of global steel, and more than 60% of energy used to make aluminium. And there is no 100% credible scenario for renewables. And as good as they are, they still need coal. The manufacture of a single wind turbine still requires 170 tons of coking coal. I have not even mentioned the role coal plays in mitigating the worst effects of poverty amongst the 800 million people who still lack access to electricity, which means no access to heat, light, fuel, and other essential services that are basic human rights. If predictions are right and the global population reaches 10 billion people by 2050, with two-thirds living in urban areas, the future is defined by urbanisation and industrialisation, which means more power, more steel, more cement. These are the facts that we communicate through the World Coal Association every day. These are the realistic facts that tie us together as an organisation of reason and responsibility. We exist as a cohesive global coalition of participants who know that coal's future lies in the Articles of the Paris Agreement, which says that all fuels and all technologies will be needed, and that coal has the technologies and impetus to transform. I am proud to say that here in South Africa, most particularly, we are making great headway in building the next wave of responsible coal participants. In the past few months, we welcomed more of the South African value chain in Barloworld and Seriti as members to this association. The chief executives of these organisations are clearly global thinkers, knowing that coal is a building block for economic and social progress, and that through technology will contribute to a sustainable future. And there are many more seeking to be part of this responsible coal community, and I welcome their guidance and collaboration. We will continue to need visionaries in South Africa, because as you well know, unabated coal contributes almost 80% of total greenhouse gas emissions, of which 50% are from electricity generation. Yet it employs more than 90,000 people throughout coal extraction in South Africa alone. Globally, coal energy with old technologies accounts for 40% of emissions, but coal mining alone employs about 8 million people and creates revenues of more than $900 billion a year. Coal underpins a large part of the world's economy, and locally, the 2019 Integrated Resource Plan identifies that coal will continue to play a significant role in electricity generation in South Africa in the foreseeable future. These are the incontrovertible facts, but we cannot leave it at that. We must keep building the brand that is coal and demonstrate that it is transforming through technology. High efficiency, low emission, carbon capture and storage, coal to hydrogen, coal to gas, coal to biomass, the list is extensive. Our new generation of coal players across the whole coal value chain know all about the disruption we're experiencing within our industry, the changing market dynamics, geopolitics, energy security, energy affordability, poverty, new non-traditional funding, asset divestments, availability of diverse energy technologies, shareholder activism, industrialisation. But the new generation of coal players have a different mindset, less about popularism, which in this day and age is definitely a road less travelled. A more robust, demonstrable outlook, which understands that all these challenges can be addressed through adherence to the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals and an allegiance to the Paris Climate Change Agreement, which says that all fuels and all technologies are required. Our road less travelled is called the true intent of Paris, which supports all fuels and all technologies. And so now, the final verse in Frost's poem, The Road Not Taken, and perhaps a hopeful premonition for our global coal value chain and community at large as we seek to reaffirm and redefine our place in the decarbonised future. I should be telling this with a sigh, he says, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less travelled by, and that has made all the difference. I hope to continue to work with all of you to make this difference. Thank you.